Today we are going to learn about the unit number 3 of basic of civil and mechanical engineering. Unit number 3 comprises of the following things. So repair and rehabilitation of structures. In that we are going to learn about the basic of corrosion phenomena and other structural distress mechanisms. Some simple systems of rehabilitation of structures. Non-destructive testing systems, use of carbon fiber wrapping and carbon composite in repair. So first point is basics of corrosion phenomena and other structural distress mechanisms. In that we should know first what is corrosion. So let us see what corrosion is. The deterioration of materials by chemical interaction with their environment. The term corrosion is sometimes also applied to the degradation of plastics, concrete, and wood, but generally refers to metals. The most widely used metal is iron, usually as steel, and the following discussion is mainly related to its corrosion. So corrosion or degradation means diffusion or decomposition of plastics and concrete and wood is there. But when with respect to degradation comes and the corrosion word comes, it is related to the metals, which is known as steel. So it's a corrosion. Some of the major harmful effects of corrosion can be summarized as follows. Reduction of metal thickness leading to loss of mechanical strength and structural failure or breakdown. When the metal is lost in localized zones so as to give a crack-like structure, very considerable weakening may result from quite a small amount of metal loss. Hazards or injuries to people arising from structural failure or breakdown. Loss of time in availability of profile making industrial equipment. So all these three points are most important. Next is the major causes of corrosion. Salt water, excellent electrolyte and chloride sources present in the salt water. Then H2S, acid gas with iron sulfide, the byproduct. CO2, major cause of produced gas corrosion. O2, key player, reduce any way possible. And corrosion types are galvanic. A potential difference between dissimilar metals in contact creates a current flow. This may also occur in some metals at the grain boundaries. So whenever this type of metals which come in contact with the flow of the current and it reacts with the metal and the corrosion takes place. Next is crevice corrosion. Intensive localized electrochemical corrosion occurs within crevices when in contact with the corrosive fluid will accelerate after start. Whenever the material of metal comes in contact with the fluid, then with respect to the cracks in that may cause corrosion. Stress corrosion occurs in metals that is subject to both stress and a corrosive environment. May start at a stress riser like a wrench mark or packer slip mark. So whenever there is a deformation and with respect to stress load upon area, and this will take place with the stress corrosion. So next is erosion corrosion. Passage of fluid at high velocity may remove the thin protective oxide film that protects exposed metal surface. Hydrogen sulfide corrosion, H2S gas or water creates an acid gas and environment resulting in F2SX and hydrogen. So erosion corrosion, fluid in contact with the metal will corrode, then hydrogen sulfide with respect to water reacts with the metal and forms corrosion. Then hydrogen embrittlement, atomic hydrogen diffuses into the grain boundary of the metal, generating trap larger molecules of hydrogen molecules, resulting in metal embrittlement. हाइड्रोजन करोजन, हाइड्रोजन ब्लिस्टरिंग, हाइड्रोजन इन एम्ब्रिटलमेंट, डीकार्बोनाइजेशन एंड हाइड्रोजन अटैक. दिस इज द करोजन ऑफ रीइंफोर्समेंट इन कॉन्क्रीट. द फिगर शोज हाउ द करोजन इन कॉन्क्रीट इज देयर एंड विच अफेक्ट्स द मेटल. क्रैक्स इन कॉन्क्रीट, क्लोराइड्स अटैक, सल्फेट अटैक, अल्कली एग्रीगेट रिएक्शन, सो डिस्ट्रेस इन स्ट्रक्चर्स. डिस्ट्रेस मीन्स डैमेज. कॉन्क्रीट में सफर डिस्ट्रेस और डैमेज ड्यूरिंग इट्स लाइफ पीरियड ड्यू टू द नंबर ऑफ रीजंस. बिकॉज ऑफ द वेयरिंग कंडीशंस अंडर विच इट इज प्रोड्यूस्ड at various locations, the quality of concrete suffers occasionally either during production or during service conditions resulting in distress. So distress is nothing but the damage. Years together, when the structure is not maintained properly, then there will be the damage, and which is called as a distress. So distresses in structures, if a building has given about 25 to 30 years of service without much maintenance or repair, then it is reasonable to expect that it would need some repair sooner or later. Okay, so for categories of reasons distress of concrete structures, first is weathering, aging, environmental effects, inadequate maintenance, poor designing and construction quality, change of loading pattern or non-conventional loading on structure, water leakage leading to corrosion of concrete structure. So all these are the main reasons why this distress can take place in the concrete structures. So types of structural distress and deterioration. This is the figure which is showing you roof leakage and water seepage. These are all the distresses, showing first figure as beam distress, then the structural failure, concrete failure, all are the distresses in concrete and steel. So stages of condition survey, prioritize distress elements according to the seriousness for repairs. First is preliminary inspection. Second is planning, visual inspection, field and laboratory testing. So preliminary inspection information is we need to cover as period of construction, how much life has been achieved and how much is left. Then construction details, drawing, architectural and structural. So both drawings are required, working and structural drawings. And different types of loading and unloading structures, columns, and each and everything. Exposure conditions, designed and present use of structure, previous changes if done, record of first occurrence or defect, details of repair carried out previously, previous reports, details from owners and photographs. So all these information is required first. So this is known as your preliminary inspection. Planning survey, information of field documents, plans and actual observation each room wise, previous report, advice if any, and implementation done as per report, grouping of structural elements, external, internal, interior, etc., exposure conditions. So all these are the information. Then classification of damage is categorized in four types. So first is G1, no distress but cosmetic repairs. G2, minor repairs, superficial repairs. G3, medium repairs, patch repairs. And G4, medium but principal repairs. And G5 are the major repairs. So all these are categorized in five types. And if any type of the repair is required, it is categorized and then solved. Visual inspection, areas of high distress, cracks and their locations, excessive deflections, exposure conditions of various distressed areas, moisture seepage, leakages, dampness, locations, abnormal vibrations in structures, algae, fungus growth, stress on the structure, photographic record, areas of immediate concern. Field and laboratory testing, identification of cause of problem, assessment and extent of damage, availability, space and accessibility with respect to ongoing activities in the building, propping structural members in case of major repairs, severely damaged elements, columns, etc., safety measures to avoid structural distress. Non-destructive evaluation test, field test, laboratory test, in-situ concrete strength, chemical attack, corrosion activity, fire damage, structural integrity and soundness. So all these are with respect to the distress. Now we are going to learn about some simple systems of rehabilitation of structures. So first is repair is the process of restoring something that is damaged or deteriorated or broken to good condition. Rehabilitation is the process of returning a building or an area to its previous good condition. Maintenance is the act of keeping something in good condition by checking or repairing it regularly. So all these three, repair, rehabilitation and maintenance, are interconnected with each other. So we have to take care that these three are managed together. So examples of repairs, decoration of structure, painting, whitewashing, checking the wiring of the building, replastering of any wall if required, repair of door and window, checking or repairing of pipeline connections, gas line connections and plumbing services, relaying disturbed roof tiles. All these are the repairs which we need to take care of. Examples of rehabilitation, to fill the white cracks using some suitable material, injecting epoxy-like material in the cracks in walls, columns, beams, etc., removal of damaged portion of masonry and reconstructing it using rich mortar mix, addition of reinforcing mesh on both sides of the wall, then retrofitting. It is the most important part whenever the earthquake structures are there. If the structure is designed by earthquake designs, taking earthquake forces into account, it is good. But if it is not, then retrofitting is done to avoid the building suffer earthquake. So earthquake creates great devastation in terms of life, money, and failures of structure. Earthquake mitigation is an important field of study for a long time. Seismic retrofitting is a collection mitigation technique for earthquake engineering. It is of utmost importance for historic monuments, areas prone to severe earthquakes, and tall or expensive structures. It is nothing but it is the modification of existing structures to make them more resistant to seismic activity, ground motion, or soil failure due to earthquake. So we have to take care of the structure which is having the seismic means earthquake forces, seismic analysis means earthquake forces analysis. So the building has to be taken care of the ground motions and modifications, or some backing is given so that the earthquake forces, if are on the building coming, then they are just not causing any harm. The retrofit techniques are also applicable for other natural hazards such as tropical cyclones, tornadoes, and severe winds from thunderstorms. Need of retrofitting. The two circumstances are earthquake damaged buildings, earthquake vulnerable buildings with no exposure to severe earthquakes. Next is need of retrofitting in existing earthquake vulnerable buildings. Some of the points are: buildings have been designed according to the seismic code, but the code has been upgraded in later years. Buildings designed to meet the modern seismic codes, but deficiencies exist in the design and or construction. Essential buildings must be strengthened like hospitals, historical monuments and architectural buildings. Important buildings whose services are assumed to be essential just after an earthquake like hospitals. Buildings, the use of which has changed through the years. Buildings that are expanded and renovated or rebuilt. So all these points we have to take care while we need to have the retrofitting. Okay. Repair methodology. First, you have to evaluation, related observations to causes, selecting methods and materials, preparing drawings and specifications, selection of the contractor, execution of the work and quality control. So all these points we have to take care when we are having to start with the repair. Okay. So we have done with the repairs, then material for crack repair, cement slurry, cement mortar, epoxy resin, polymer modified cementitious products. So all these materials we are using for the repair methodology. So crack repair techniques, you can use some of these following conditions: epoxy injection grouting, routing and sealing, flexible sealing, stitching, providing additional reinforcement, drilling and plugging, pre-stressing stress, steel, grouting, dry packing, surface coatings. Let us see some of them over here. So these are the epoxy injection grouting. You can see that at the intervals, the grouting is done and the repair is done inside the concrete. So this is the routing and sealing. If these are the cracks, then the epoxy or the material is added in the concrete and they are sealed. These are the stitching by the using materials and the epoxy or any other materials, using the stitches are done on the walls. Then these are the pre-stressing steel. If the slab is developed, then the pre-stressing is done by introducing this steel inside the slab. This is the cement grouting, chemical grouting and epoxy grouting. So non-destructive testing systems, these has been defined as comprising those test methods used to examine an object, material or system without impairing its future usefulness. The term is generally applied to non-medical investigations of material integrity. So there are certain instruments which are used to calculate the strength of the concrete and the steel of the existing building. Those are known as non-destructive testing systems. So there are following different methods of NDT: penetration method, rebound hammer method, pull-out test method, ultrasonic pulse velocity method, radioactive methods. So first, if you can see penetration method, there are invisible cracks, porosity and other defects on the surface of components easily detected by this technique. Components may be ferrous, non-ferrous, plastic, glass or ceramic. Now let us see the procedure: cleaning of the surface with grease, oil and other material, drying of the surface, applying dry penetrant on clean and dry surface. It is allowed to penetrate in surface flows. So two methods are there. First is liquid soluble penetrant, another is fluorescent. After that, removing excess penetrant by soft or clean cloth, applying developer on the surface. So this is how the penetration method is done. So this is the first step: crack are filled with dirt, then ideally cleaned, then application of penetrant is done, then intermediate cleaning is done, then application of developer is done, and then the cracks are indication. So this is first is the application, second is cleaning, applying developer and interpretation. So these are all the stages of the penetration test. Rebound hammer. So rebound hammer is 1.8 kg. If you can see, this is the hammer. And this is having a spring here. If you inject it inside the concrete, then it will give the recording by the spring on this scale, and it will give the strength of the concrete and the steel inside, so that you are able to know what is the current strength of that particular structure. Pullout method. This is the pullout method. In this, you are just applying the instrument on the surface of slab or a beam. It is going inside the tensile flexural plane, and the value is given out, and the concrete strength is measured on the device. This is the ultrasonic pulse method. When you apply the ultrasonic pulse instrument on the surface of the slab or a beam, if you are having it diagonally, it will give the frequency, rebound it, and will give the measurement on your particular screen. So this is your beam, suppose, sample, and you are applying these two electrodes of the ultrasonic pulse velocity instrument on the surfaces. Then this instrument, it will give the strength of the required concrete. So these are the instrument detectors which are used, and after knowing all the values, then you can calculate the total strength of the current structure. Then radioactive method, then the wavelength is passed, and when the wavelength is passed, the value goes on the surface area. Wherever there is a void is detected, and grouting is done. And this is the instrument, corrosion detection in pipelines. These are the pipelines. The instruments is set on this, and the values are collected in the instruments. And these values, if they are high peak, then the corrosion level is high. It is indicated, and the repairs are done. So use of carbon fiber wrapping and carbon composites in repairs. So what is a carbon fiber? A material consisting of thin, strong crystalline filament of carbon used as strengthening material, especially in resins and ceramics, is known as a carbon fiber. What is the history of fiber? Carbon fibers were developed in the 1950s by heating strands of rayon until they carbonized. In 1960s, a process was developed using polyacrylonitrile as a raw material. And during the 1970s, experimental work to find alternative raw materials led to the introduction of carbon fibers made from a petroleum pitch derived from oil processing. So this is what is the history of fiber. This is the structural model of the carbon fiber. You can see how complicated it is. Next is the repairing structures using carbon fiber. If you can see, this is the roofing material, and this is the friction damp. These are the CFRP plates which are applied on the total structures, and then the carbon fibers are attached to it so that the repair is done and the structure is gaining more strength. So here, if you can see, the plates and strips are used to strengthen the structure. These are the carbon fiber sheets which are wrapped, and the beams are having more strengthening with respect to using of these carbon fibers. Thank you so much, students. Today we have just this much. In next class, we'll see the unit number 3, part B. Thank you. If you have any doubts, any questions, you can call me anytime. Thank you so much.